بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. Some years back, I received a message from one of my colleagues from the Islamic University of Medina. And in this clip that he sent me on WhatsApp, there was something about one of the heroes of Islam who had went 50-0 on the battlefield. Never lost a battle. 50 victories and zero losses. And right away, I said, SubhanAllah, yani we know about Floyd Money Mayweather and his boxing. He's 50-0, never lost. We know about Khabib. He's 29-0. But this great Muslim leader, commander, who never lost a battle, and most of us have never even heard of him.
Nakon selama i bismile, hoću da vam kažem da sam prije nekoliko godina, braćo, dobio iz Medine na WhatsApp jednu poruku. U toj poruci se spomenuo jedan heroj, čovjek koji je borio se u 50 borbi i nikada za svog života nije izgubio ni jednu bitku. Ja sam se čudio, ko je taj heroj? Da ima neko u istoriji Islama da tako se bori i da nema ni jedan poraz u svom životu. I vi znate, čuli ste za ovoga boksera McFlay ili kako se već zove?
Mayweather.
Onda čuli ste za Habiba, toliko o mom poznavanju boksa. Čuli ste za Habiba, čuli ste da oni nisu izgubili ni jednu bitku. Međutim, ovo je nešto sasvim drugo. Pa mene je zanimalo, ko je taj heroj, ko je taj junak da je u svom životu uspio toliko pobjeda izvojevati i da nikad nije izgubio.
This commander, he was so powerful that the Europeans, they feared him. And when he died, they actually had a party on top of his grave. And many of them, even as they were partying, they warned the others to be careful because they were still scared of him even though he was dead in his grave. And this man was Al-Hajib Al-Mansur Muhammad ibn Abi Amir rahimahullahu ta'ala. And just as him, we heard a couple of years later when the film Urturul, not getting into the issues of the film being halal or haram issues in the film, but the actual individual who was Urturul rahimahullahu ta'ala, most Muslims never even heard of him before. But he was someone, a very small number, very powerful in what he did. And he's the one who established for his son Uthman to then later establish the Ottoman Empire. But yet even Urturul, even though everything he had done, how much he had accomplished, Muslims around the world had never heard of him before.
Ovaj čovjek, ovaj heroj, njega su bojali se, predstavljao je strah i trepet za Evropu. Do mjere da kada su čuli da je on umro, oni su to učinili praznikom. Ali govorili su nekim ljudima, nemojte se puno opustiti. Možda nešto iza te njegove smrti se krije. Ovaj čovjek se zvao Al-Hajib ibn Mansur. I vjerovatno, vi možda niste ranije čuli za njega, kao što većina nas nije čula za njega ranije. Isto kao što nismo čuli za Ertogula, dok nismo čuli da ima neka serija. Ja kažem, sad neću da ulazim u to kakva je ta serija, ima li u toj seriji harama ili nema harama. Nevezano za sadržaj serije, pitanje da mi čujemo za nekoga koji je osnivač Osmanske države, Osmanskog carstva, preko takvog nekog programa je nešto što kod nas budi radoznalost vezano i za ovog čovjeka Al-Hajiba ibn Mansura.
I then remembered a story of a famous Iraqi general who later became a practicing Muslim and wrote many books, especially about the battles in the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which was Mahmud Shid Khattab rahimahullahu ta'ala. In the introduction in one of his books, talking about the battles of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he mentioned a story when he was an Iraqi officer, army officer. He was sent from Iraq to Germany to take a course. And as they were sitting there, the Iraqi students in the morning, waiting for the German professor to come in, when he finally comes in, he says, today we're going to be learning about the sirah, the biography of one of the greatest commanders in the history of mankind, Khalid al-Mulid. And here's this Arab, Iraqi, you know, the Iraqis back then, especially they're talking about the, you know, the pro-Arab movement and all of this, the Hizb al-Ba'ath, you know, this movement for just pro-Arabism. And here he is saying, we in the Arab countries don't study the biography of Khalid al-Mulid, but yet the non-Muslims here in Europe are telling us the biography of this great commander of the Muslims, Khalid al-Mulid, rahimahullah ta'ala.
Ovo me podsjetilo na jednog historičara iz Bagdada, Mahmuda al-Khattaba, koji je prije nego što je počeo pisati o istoriji bio general u iračkoj vojsci. Naime, on je, kako su različite vojske sarađivale, jedne prilike došao u Europu na edukaciju. I dok je on sa svojim činovima sjedio među tim vojnim osobljem u Europi, neko od tih prisutnih kaže, sada ćemo studirati, izučavati biografiju jednog od najvećih vojskovođa u istoriji čovječanstva, Halida ibn Velida. Biografiju Halida ibn Velida. Kaže, i on se zaprepastio. Halida ibn Velida studiraju u Europi kao vojskovođu, a mi u arapskom svijetu nemamo pojma o njegovim bitkama, nemamo pojma o njegovom životopisu, nemamo pojma o njegovim strategijama kao vojskovođi. Pa je on rekao, jer to je bilo u jeku arapskog buđenja ili buđenja arapskog nacionalizma u arapskom svijetu, kaže, zar je moguće da Evropljani studiraju biografiju Halida ibn Velida, a mi, Arapi, da smo to zanemarili?
If we were to ask the question, why do we know so little about our own history as Muslims? And there's many reasons, but perhaps there's two main reasons. First of all, we have spoon-fed history that we are fed by the enemies, not by Muslims. They tell us about their history and about their version or versions of world history and what happened throughout history, and we take this in as this is the history of the world, not knowing our own history. And the second thing is the fact that we don't read. We're the ummah of iqra that doesn't iqra. we're the ummah of read that doesn't read, subhanAllah. And I remember one of my students, he told me something one time about a Hollywood movie. I won't mention the name, but he said, you're going to like this clip here. And he came and showed me about two people in prison, the leaders of this gang in prison. And as they're talking about their gang activities, at the end, he says, do you like to read? And he said, yes. And he said, I'll send you over some of my favorites of this and that. And then he said something very amazing at the end of the clip. He said, the warrior's strongest asset is his mind. And seeing this clip, I said, subhanAllah, here they are in prison, criminals. But they understand the power of reading and educating themselves.
Postavlja se pitanje, šta se to desilo sa nama, muslimanima, da ne znamo, ne poznajemo svoju istoriju? Šta se to desilo da smo toliko otuđeni od svoje istorije, a imamo tako lijepu i bogatu istoriju? Postoje dva razloga. Prvi razlog je što mi prihvatamo ono što nam drugi kazuju o istoriji čovječanstva i o našoj istoriji. Mi ne uzimamo istoriju od naših historičara, već uzimamo istoriju ono što nam nude i podstavljaju ili poturaju naši neprijatelji. I to je prvi razlog. A drugi razlog je, braćo, to što mi ne čitamo. Mi smo umet ikra, čitaj, a ne čitamo. To je jedan veliki hendikep za nas. I sad ću vam ispričati šta mi se desilo jedne prilike. Jedan brat mi je poslao klip iz jednog hollywoodskog filma, neću spominjati o kojem se filmu radi. I toliko mi je bilo zanimljivo da radi se u filmu o tome da su ljudi u zatvoru i dvojica prijatelja pričaju u zatvoru i kaže jedan drugom, voliš li ti da čitaš? Kaže, on voli. Kaže, ja ću ti poslati svoje omiljene knjige da čitaš. Ili da ću ti da pročitaš omiljene knjige. Kaže, zapamti, da je ratnikovo najveće i najbolje oružje njegovo razmišljanje. Kaže, toliko sam se zaprepastio. Pazite, u zatvoru, dakle, postoji mogućnost da ništa ne mogu raditi, ali u zatvoru jedan drugome oporučuju čitanje jer znaju kolika je moć znanja i kolika je moć obrazovanja.
If we were to ask the question, why is studying history so powerful? There's many things that we gain when we study history, especially our history, or history in general. And that is, first of all, to benefit from the good their stories have to offer. Because not all the time, what is in the modern days that we live in is better. Just as we say when it comes to the religion, to follow the way of the Salaf, the early generations of Islam, also you'll find many things throughout history, what they had was actually better back then, so we can benefit from the good things they had in their life. Also, we can benefit from many of the success stories throughout history. If you look at the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, the biggest success story in the history of mankind, and we see how they did it. What did they do? What did they avoid? So we can follow in their footsteps. You look at different Muslim rulers, commanders, scholars, and look at their success stories. Look, for example, at Muhammad al-Fatih rahimahullah ta'ala. We always look at the end, how he conquered Constantinople, Istanbul, as we know today. But what did he do in the beginning in order to reach that? The fact that he spoke 5 languages. The fact he learned how to fight and was a warrior from a young age. The fact he knew Sahih al-Bukhari very well and had memorized the Quran. And he was someone who had these skills and had a vision. He had a vision from a young age. You benefit from that. His vision is to conquer that great city, to be the one that came in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he strove for it. So those type of success stories are an inspiration for us when we read them.
Kada hoćemo ili zbog čega treba da čitamo istoriju, jesu mnoge stvari, između ostalog, dvije su možda dobre da ih spomenemo na početku. Prva stvar je da vidimo da u istoriji, tokom istorije, bilo je mnogo dobrih momenata, dobrih stvari. Mi nekada mislimo da je u našem vremenu sve najbolje, međutim, kada pogledamo natrag, nazad u istoriju, vidimo da je bilo puno dobrih stvari, puno boljih stvari nego u našem vremenu kada uporedimo. I zato mi kažemo Selefu Salih, dobri prethodnici. Oni su sigurno bili u svojoj primjeni vjere bolji nego što je to danas stanje među muslimanima. A druga stvar jeste da kroz istoriju i iz istorije naučimo da iskustva koja su bila, na njima naučimo kako mi ta iskustva da iskoristimo. I vidite, puno je uspješnih primjera u istoriji koje mi zanemarujemo. Mnogo ih je. Od toga kako su Allahu poslanik alejhi salatu vesselam, odnosno ashabi, bili generacija koja je neponovljiva po svom uspjehu u istoriji čovječanstva. Za veoma kratko vrijeme i znanje, ono što je Allah objavio, i vojskom oslobođeno, ono što je oslobođeno za veoma kratko vrijeme. Da ne govorimo o kasnijim primjerima, kao što je primjer Mehmeda el-Fatiha, rahmetullahi alejhi. Mi samo gledamo ono što je bio krajnji rezultat, ono što je njegov najveći uspjeh. Međutim, koji je bio to put do uspjeha? To nekada zanemarujemo. E, istorija nam pomaže da shvatimo i kako se dolazi, koji su to koraci koji dovode do uspjeha. Pa Mehmed el-Fatih, malo ljudi zna da je on već kao mlad momak bio prvo dobro odgojen, drugo strašno dobro je poznavao Sahih Buharije, zatim da je znao Kur'an, zatim da je on imao viziju, znao Kur'an na pamet, zatim da je imao viziju, a njegova vizija i želja je bila da osvoji Konstantinopol, kojeg mi danas znamo kao Istanbul. Pa je on u toj svojoj viziji spremao se za veliki zadatak, jer je želio da bude onaj koji je spomenut u hadisu Allahovog poslanika, alejhi salatu vesselam, blago se onome ko bude osvojio Konstantinopol. Šta je to što je dovelo do tog uspjeha? Mi to nekada zanemarujemo, a istorija je upravo ta koja nas uči da i mi radimo slično onome što su radili na putu da dođemo do velikih ciljeva.
Even if we look at the history of other nations, other than the Muslims, there's many things that we can benefit. If you look at the story, for example, of Nelson Mandela, someone who was in prison for 27 years, but he still had the vision on changing his society, and with that sabr and striving, he was able to do it later. We can benefit from stories like that. Also, if you look, for example, at my people, Qawmi, the Irish Americans, who many historians say is one of the most successful success stories of a nation in history. Why is that? When they went to America, our forefathers, they were forced during the famine to migrate to America out of hunger, looking for a new way. When they arrived, who was in charge there? The same English who had taken over our country. So we're Bayna Narain, between two fires, as they say, right? They wouldn't let us work in normal places. They made our women work as servants. We had to work difficult jobs. Within 50 years, we became equal to the rest of the people there. Okay, this is from history books. That was in 1900, the Irish were just like the other Euro-Americans, European Americans. 1950, they became the top of the race in America until today. They're in charge of everything when it comes to the army, many of the presidents, the police. You'll find there's always Irish people behind it. A success story. As a Muslim, we know from the hadith, even though it's da'if and the Sheikh, mashallah, is a PhD in hadith, so you have to be careful, make sure. with the hadith, it's not authentic, but the meaning is correct, as the scholar said, al-hikmatu dalatu al-mu'min, that the wisdom is the lost belonging of the believer. So we find hikmah, even if it's from non-Muslims, we can take it. And the last thing we'll mention when it comes to studying history is to avoid the mistakes that they fell into. So for example, we talked about the Ottoman Empire, how it rose. We also need to know how it fell. What did they do? Andalus, we know how it rose. How did it fall? We need to know these stories as well so we don't fall into the same mistakes as individuals and as our societies around the world.
Od uspjeha ili historijskih priča, događaja koji nam pokazuju da su ljudi uspjeli i kako su uspjeli, jeste jedan primjer koji je poznat opće Nelsona Mandele, južnoafričkog predsjednika, koji je prije toga 27 godina bio na robi. 27 godina u zatvoru. Međutim, imao je viziju. Imao je viziju i želju šta da uradi. I na kraju je uspio u onoj svojoj viziji. Isto tako, moj narod čijeg sam ja porijekla, to su Amerikanci irskog porijekla, jer šejh je Amerikanac irskog porijekla, oni su, kaže, isto tako jedna uspješna priča. Pokazali su kako mogu da uspiju ljudi u historiji. Naime, oni su kada su trebali doseliti se u Ameriku, uslijed velike gladi su otišli za Ameriku. I kada su došli u Ameriku, zapravo su predstavljali jedan marginalizirani dio društva. Od tog marginaliziranog dijela društva, gdje su oni radili obične poslove, žene su radile kao služavke, oni su za 15 godina uspjeli da oni koji su ih ranije marginalizirali, da budu na istom stepenu, na istom položaju u društvu. Pa su iz tog društva, iz tog dijela stanovništva koje se doselilo u Ameriku, došli kasnije ljudi koji će postati predsjednici, koji će postati generali u vojsci, koji će postati političari, koji će voditi mnogo pozitivnih procesa u američkom društvu. To je još jedna uspješna priča kroz istoriju, iz istorije. I takvih je priča mnogo, svejedno, od muslimana ili nemuslimana. Treća stvar koja nam je potrebna ili zbog koje nam je važno da studiramo istoriju jeste da naučimo na tuđim greškama, na greškama koje su se dešavale ljudima u istoriji. Naprimjer, kako je došlo do toga da formira se tako veliko carstvo, Osmansko carstvo, i šta su razlozi koji su doveli do njegovog propadanja i nestajanja? Isto tako Endelus. Endelus je bila jedna velika civilizacija, jedna velika kultura, jedna ogromna, ogromna zajednica koja je cvjetala. Šta se desilo da nakon takvog uspjeha ta civilizacija, da Endelus propadne i nestane? Zbog toga nam je važno, kao što stoji u jednom hadisu, iako je hadis slab, da se kaže, mudrost je izgubljena stvar vjernika, gdje god je nađe, on je uzme. Pa tako, ne mora samo biti da uzmemo ibret, pouku iz onoga što se desilo muslimanima, možemo to naučiti i na nemuslimanima.
When it comes to the spoon-fed history that we mentioned, that they feed us, they tell us about their history, and we study their history, and they glorify their history, and they cover up all of the negative aspects of their history. So they don't tell you, for example, when they tell you they discovered America, who discovered America? Christopher Columbus, they say, huh? Some say he was drunk and found it by mistake. But anyways, they claim he's the one who discovered America. Not realizing or not admitting and telling you that it's been on the Muslim maps for generations before that. Hundreds of years before that, the Muslim sailors who sailed around the world, that they had America on their maps. It was already known to them. And in many places in South America, you'll find the archaeologists, when they dug through the grounds and earth and their findings, they found Masajid. The Muslims were there many, many, many years before. They don't tell us this part. They don't tell us how the Americans slaughtered the genocide of the American Indians, or about this, even the Spanish colonizations who were there in America, and they completely slaughtered them, annihilated hundreds of thousands of them, completely slaughtered all of them. They don't tell you this part of the history. Just they came to save the day and make America great and make the whole world great or around great. They don't tell you this part of the history. And that will be anywhere, not just America. The West as well, they'll tell you certain parts of the history and glorify other parts. But they won't tell you the reality of history, and they don't want you to know your own history.
Da se vratimo malo onome što smo spomenuli, da mi obično prihvatamo ono što nam se ponudi od historije i onoga što se dešavalo u historiji, kao što je recimo opće poznata historija koju nam nudi Zapad, dok oni pozitivno samo govore i veličaju svoju historiju, a prikrivaju dosta stvari koje su negativne o svojoj historiji. Pa tako, na primjer, opće poznato je da je Kristofer Kolumbo otkrio Ameriku. Međutim, mnogo prije Kristofera Kolumba mi ćemo vidjeti kod muslimana moreplovaca da su oni na svojim kartama imali obilježenu Ameriku. Isto tako, arheološka istraživanja, nalazišta, pokazuju da je bilo mesdžida na američkom tlu, odnosno južnoameričkom tlu, koja su otkrivena, koja su mesdžide koji su pravili moreplovci koji su se tu doseljavali daleko prije Kristofera Kolumba. Ali oni, veličajući svoju istoriju, prikazuju samo ono što je u njihovom interesu i prikrivaju određene činjenice istorijske koje njima ne idu u prilog. Kao što je slučaj sa tim da su istrijebili genocidom, znači genocid napravili nad čitavom populacijom ljudi na kontinent na koji su došli. Kako u Sjevernoj Americi, tako i u Južnoj Americi, ono što su uradili Španci na stotine hiljada ljudi, doslovno su bili eliminisani, ubijani. To se ne spominje mnogo, zato što ne ide u prilog onome ko daje jednu verziju istorije. I zato mi treba da znamo da i taj aspekt istorije treba da bude, da ga uzmemo sa rezervom, odnosno da znamo da u našoj istoriji ima onoga što je itekako pozitivno u odnosu na ono što nam se nudi.
The question comes is, why don't they want us to know our history? Because if we know our history, we're going to know about the great history that we have and the great leaders that we had and all they accomplished. We're going to know, as we mentioned, Al-Hajib al-Mansur, rahimahullah ta'ala, 50-0 on the battlefield. We know about Urturul and these. We start to learn about some of the Sahaba and some of the stories we're going to share with you tonight. Talking about real life superheroes. Not Spider-Man and Batman and Superman. No, the real deal. Not these, you know, martial arts, you know, whatever the famous, who I don't know who's famous these days, huh? In the movies, but you know, back in my day, like Jean-Claude Van Damme or some people like that were the famous ones. I'm getting old, so I don't know. I don't know the new guys yet. They make these guys like Rambo, for example. These are the superheroes, right? But the real thing, we actually have those in Islam. They don't want Muslims to know that, because now Muslims are looking around the world like, we don't have any role models. We don't have anyone to look up to throughout history. Like, we're masakin. When they talk about the dark ages, yes, it was dark ages for them, but it was the golden ages for the Muslims around the world. We look at the West, all the modern inventions and science and all of this, mashallah, look what they've done. It's all built upon what the Muslim inventors and scientists found earlier. And many of them admit that, and there's been books written about that. But the problem is, we don't know our own history. We don't know what we have. Modern studies, modern universities. Who founded these modern universities? Was it Muslims? Muslims had universities way before they did. But they don't want the Muslims to know this. So the Muslims come up in the world like, we never accomplished anything. We don't know what we accomplished. We're looking at the West. Wow, look what they've done, right? And that's why many people, they go astray from their deen, because they think the Muslims are masakin. They never done anything. Look at the West, what they've accomplished without religion. So they think that's the path to follow.
I zato, braćo, što oni veličaju svoju istoriju, namjerno nam ne govore o našoj istoriji. I onda mi, gledajući samo tu verziju istorije, gledamo na njih kao da je kod njih sva veličina, a kod muslimana da nema nikakvih veličina, da nema nikakvih uspjeha, da nema nikakve istorije. A zapravo, kada bismo pogledali unatrag, vidjeli bismo da je historija muslimana puna velikih podviga, puna velikih ljudi, puna velikih velikana, koji su po današnjoj nekoj terminologiji pravi superheroji. To nisu ni Batman, ni Superman, ni Rambo, ni koje je već šejh naveo likove koje smo mi kao djeca, on govori, gledali kroz filmove. Dakle, ovo su bili pravi ljudi koji su bili neustrašivi borci, heroji, koji su doprinosili svom društvu. I o tome se kod nas ništa ne govori. Ne poznajemo te činjenice. I vidite ovo. Muslimani kad gledaju na Zapad, koji o sebi samo govori pozitivno, i ne znaju svoju istoriju, svoju veličanstvenu istoriju, veličanstvenu istoriju muslimana, oni kažu, vidiš, pa mi onda i onako nemamo ništa. Još kad vidi tehnologija kako je uznapredovala, kaže, vidiš, kod njih tehnologija, kod nas nema. Univerziteti koji postoje kod njih kažu, pa gdje? Međutim, sve ono što je dostiglo tehnološki napredak kakav je dostiglo, zapravo se oslanja na izume koje su napravili muslimani. Ono što su izumili muslimani. Univerziteti koji postoje danas, oni su bazirani, osnovani su po uzoru na univerzitete koji su postojali kod muslimana. I kada neko gleda, poredi, vidiš, kaže, kako oni, a gledaj, kaže, kako muslimani. To može da ga dovede u strašno iskušenje. Kaže, oni su sigurno u pravu, na istini, čim su tako napredni, a gledaj, muslimani ovako slabi, nazadni, i to može da mu bude razlog da se sasvim okrene prema zapadnim vrijednostima, zapadnom vjerovanju, i da okrene se od vjerovanja koje nose muslimani.
They accomplish this by controlling the narrative. So when it comes to news, what is correct is what they say. What is wrong is what they say. And then it comes to history as well. So they'll distort the facts of their own history and even of our history as Muslims. So they'll come to a great Muslim commander and ruler, Amr ibn al-As, radiallahu anhu, and they'll tell you that this man was a war criminal. And they'll make up lies and misconceptions about him. And they'll come to a true war criminal, like Napoleon, and they'll glorify him. Even though Napoleon was known for what he did to the black slaves in the Haitian Revolution, when he put them into a gas chamber, 140 years before Hitler, by the way, 140 years before him, put them in the gas chamber and killed up to 100,000 of those slaves, in some of the narrations. But yet they come with this man and they glorify him, and they will come and talk negatively about the Muslims in their history and what they did when they came and conquered Spain, when they conquered Constantinople, when they conquered Egypt and these countries. Even though when you go back and read the history yourself, you'll find the people were, even the ones who didn't accept Islam, they were happy with the Muslim rule because they found of the justice, the adla was established in the countries once the Muslims came there.
Jedan od načina kako su postigli da muslimani zapravo ne gledaju pozitivno na svoju istoriju jeste narativ koji su uzeli kada govori se o historijskim događajima. A jedan od narativa jeste da govori se isključivo i glorificira ono što je dešavalo se na zapadu, vojskovođe koji su bili na zapadu, dok se isključivo negativno ili uglavnom u negativnom svjetlu priča o muslimanskim osvajačima i muslimanskim vojskovođama i vladarima. Pa ćete vidjeti, na primjer, da je Amr ibn el-As, radijallahu anhu, koji je osvojio Egipat, predstavljen kao jedan zločinac, neko koji je počinio gnusne zločine prilikom svojih osvajanja. Dok s druge strane imate Napoleona Bonapartu. Napoleon Bonaparta predstavljen je isključivo i samo kao veliki vojskovođa i veliki lider. I gotovo nikako se ne spominju zločini koje je on radio. A on je na svom putu osvajanja pravio mnogobrojne zločine. Ne samo to, nego na Haitiju on je imao gasne komore u kojima je na stotine hiljada ljudi ugušio. Na stotinu hiljada ljudi. I to 140 godina prije Hitlera. Pa kad pogledamo kako su se oni ili kako se odnose u svom historijskom narativu, u svom prikazivanju historije prema svojim liderima, bez obzira što su oni činili mnoge zločine, i kako predstavljaju muslimane, muslimanske lidere, vidjet ćeš u kom smjeru ide ono što oni pričaju. Oni ne žele da se dijelovi historije umeta islamskog predstavljaju u pozitivnom svjetlu, već žele da to ostave samo za sebe, i kroz ovaj narativ oni između ostalog ostavljaju takav dojam da je kod njih sve pozitivno, a kod muslimana u njihovoj istoriji sve nazadno i prilično blijedo i šturo.
Subhanallah, even when it comes to fiction, they were able to spread their history around the world. There was a movie that they made, I don't know if it's still famous or not, but The Three Musketeers. I don't know if you've heard of The Three Musketeers or not. They made movies about them. And they were actually, if you go back to the story, there were three drunk soldiers who were supposed to guard the king in France. And they were obviously losers in what they did. They were unsuccessful. But they made a joke about it, and they spread their story throughout the world, translated it into many languages. And we know it in America, and we're not even French, right? So this is something we grew up with. But if you ask many Muslims, they might know about the three musketeers in their story. But if you ask them about the three Muslim commanders who had with them only about 3,000 soldiers and were able to defeat an army, fully equipped army of the Roman Empire of 200,000, they don't want you to know this story. They don't tell you this story. This is, as they say, ilm al-hadith ma yutwa wa la yurwa. From what you don't, you hide it and you don't narrate it. So they don't want us to know this history about these great commanders.
Također, kada se govori o istoriji, čak i u fikciji, u književnosti, odnosno onoga što slijedi iz književnosti, njihovi junaci predstavljaju se pozitivnim. Kao što su, na primjer, tri musketira, tri čovjeka koji su bili pijanice, koji se prikazuju u književnosti, kasnije kroz kinematografiju, oni se prikazuju kao neku ko je pozitivan, pozitivno junak, iako su bili propalice, iznevjerili su svog vladara i bili su banditi. Međutim, oni su predstavljeni kao neko ko je borac, kao neko ko je pozitivna ličnost. I tako smo mi u Americi, ako to je francuska priča iz francuske književnosti, mi smo odrasli sa tim da su to bili velikani. Za razliku od 3000 boraca muslimana, koji su njih 3000 borili se sa potpuno do zuba naoružanom, potpuno opremljenom vojskom, bizantijskom vojskom od 200.000 boraca. Gdje su oni, njih 3000, uspjeli da se suprotstave tolikoj vojsci i da ne izgube. I bio to priči, ništa ne znamo. Ne znamo da su ti ljudi ni postojali, ne znamo ni ko su oni bili, ni kada su se borili, ni ništa ne znamo o tom velikom događaju. A oni prvi, oni su, iako su samo fikcija, izmišljeni likovi, oni se veličaju.
Do they know the three musketeers or they didn't reach Bosnia?
Znate li ovo tri musketeera?
What about the three Muslim commanders of this army? First of all, what battle was it in and who were the three Muslim commanders? This is a question.
Ko su kaže ovih tri komandanta koja su vodila ovu vojsko 3000 ljudi koji su borili protiv Bizantinaca.
What was the battle? Who knows?
Koja je bila bitka? Koja je bitka u pitanju? Bitka na Jermuku. Je li bitka na Jermuku?
Ne. Kabla Jermuka.
Prije Jermuka, kaže. Koja je bila prije Jermuka?
With him. During the life of the Prophet sallallahu alejhi ve sellem.
Za vrijeme poslanika sallallahu alejhi ve sellem.
Muta.
Muta. Bitka na Muti.
Who were the commanders? The three Muslim commanders?
Ko su bili komandanti?
The Prophet ﷺ, he told the Sahaba about the story as it happened. Subhanallah. This is from the Wahi. He told them as they died, one after the other, the three commanders. And then who came and took over?
Poslanik alejhi salatu vesselam je spominjao ovu trojicu komandanata prilikom njihove pogibije, dok su oni ginuli. Znači, samo je Wahi mogao znati šta se dešava na bojnom polju. Ko su oni bili?
I said, Akhada rajata Zaid. Zaid ibn Haritha, for Usib. And then he was killed. And he had put the command for three of them. The next one was who? Ja'far. Ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. Khadarai. Then he became in charge. And then he was killed. And then after that, Abdullah ibn Ruwaha. And then he was killed after that. He was the third one killed. Then he said, Thumma khadarayata sayful min siyufillah. Then who came in charge was a sword from the swords of Allah. Who was this man? This real life superhero. Not someone in the stories, Rambo. Not the real deal. In this battle, eight swords. Eight. He broke eight swords in this battle. What was he doing? Was he sitting back telling the soldiers to go? He was in the front lines, breaking swords on heads. Eight swords. This is a real life superhero in battle. But yet, Muslims say, we don't know about this, right?
Dakle, ovi heroji, braćo i sestre, spomenuti su u hadisu kojem poslanik alejhi salatu vesselam kaže zastavu, dakle predvodnik je uzeo Zaid, to jest misli se na Zaida ibn Harisu radijallahu ta'ala anhu, pa je pogođen, ubijen. Potom je zastavu uzeo Džafer ibn Ebi Talib, pa je ubijen. To poslanik alejhi salatu vesselam govori kako se bitka odvija, dakle nema interneta, nego vahju mu dolazi ta obavijest. Pa je ubijen Džafer radijallahu anhu. Pa je onda zastavu preuzeo Abdullah ibn Ravaha radijallahu anhu i on je, kaže poslanik alejhi salatu selam, ubijen. Pa je poslije toga, kaže poslanik alejhi salatu selam, zastavu uzeo čovjek koji je jedna od Allahovih sablji. I potom je dobio naziv Allahova sablja, Halid ibn Walid radijallahu anhu. Pa je on na sebi, sa sobom je nosio osam sablji. Zašto osam sablji? On ih je razbijao od glave neprijatelja. Kad se slomi sablja, uzima se druga. To je pravi superheroj o kojem, vidite, ne znamo gotovo ništa. Pravi superheroj, pravi lik. Nije fikcija. Čovjek koji je živio, koji je dio naše ponosne, lijepe istorije.
When we look at Superman flying through the air, and all our kids know this, Spider-Man, and you have our kids in the house, and they want to be like Spider-Man or Superman or Batman. But do they know Al-Qa'qa? Al-Qa'qa ibn Amr, Al-Tamimi, radiallahu anhu, rahimahullah. The one during the Battle of Al-Qadisiyah who killed a huge elephant by himself. This is the real deal. Once again, it's not something from fiction, from stories, it's the real thing. He killed, in this battle, by himself, killed a massive, an elephant they used for war back in the day. Some of the empires, they had these elephants they would use in the battlefield to storm the other opposite army. He's the one who killed this all by himself. And he's the one that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu said about him, that the voice, Sult al-Qa'qa, the voice of the Qa'qa and the army, he said it's better than 1,000 men. Just his voice. And he said that the army that has Al-Qa'qa in it, they will never be defeated. But we ask Muslims around the world, who is Al-Qa'qa? Most of us don't know, Allahumma stan.
Jeste li, braćo, čuli za Qa'qa ibn Amra et-Tamimija? On je još jedan naš superheroj iz istorije. Naime, Qa'qa je prilikom bitke na Kadisiji svojim rukama ubio slona. Dakle, nije to izmišljeno. Slona, ljudi, svojim rukama, sam, nije mu niko pomagao, nije imao 1000 ljudi sa sobom. To je Qa'qa ibn Amr et-Tamimi. Taj čovjek koji je bio u vojsci sa Ebu Bekrom radijallahu anhu, za njega Ebu Bekr kaže, njegov glas vrijedi više od 1000 ljudi. Kaže, neće poraziti ili neće biti poražena vojska u kojoj se nađe Qa'qa. I jeste li ikad čuli za njega? A jesu, Badhum se mi ubija. Uglavnom većina ljudi ne zna za Al-Qa'qa ibn Amr.
If you look at Ali ibn Abi Talib radijallahu an, a real life superhero, and on the battlefield, the real deal, not someone, you know, someone with no fiction here. And this is how we become so attached to the, you know, the Hollywood superstars and these superheroes. We don't realize we actually have the real deal in Islam. We have the real thing. In the Battle of Al-Khandaq, there was a, when they had surrounded the Medina, and there was a man by the name of Amr Abd Wud. Amr Abd Wud was also undefeated. He was one of the most fierce warriors from the Arab, from the Mushrikeen. And you know it from the custom that they had in the battles, they had something called Al-Mubaraza, which is a duel between two or three people, one person, one-on-one, and that has an impact on the soldiers and the outcome usually of the battle. So there'll be two or three or one, like you remember the battle of Badr, three of them came out and they fought each other. That's at the beginning. That was their custom. So Amr Abd Wud, who was someone who was, people were scared of him, he said, who will come out to fight me? Without any hesitation, Ali ibn Abi Talib, he gets up. Ana, it's me. Prophet ﷺ, he sat him down a bit. You know, he wants strategic battle now. He calls out again. Ali, he gets up to go. You know, here he's going. And then at the end, the Prophet said, let him go. And he went and he defeated this undefeatable soldier. People thought no one could beat him. But yet he beat him. Also with Marhab al-Yahudi, if you go back and read the story, someone who couldn't be who would be defeated, and Ali ibn Abi Talib is the one who defeated him in the end.
Isto tako, bio jedan junak među Arapima, Abd ibn Abd Wud, ili ibn
Amr Abd Wud.
Amr ibn Wud. Pa je bio strašan, neustrašiv ratnik. Do mjere da niti je kada izgubio, niti se koga bojao. I pročulo se, već je imao pedigre da ga se svi boje. Međutim, kada je on ustao, kada su trebali sukobiti muslimani, sa muslimanima, a vi znate na početku, ili bio je običaj prilikom ratovanja, da prije početka bitke izađu na dvoboj ljudi. Pa izađe iz oba suparnička ili suparničkih vojski, suprotstavljenih vojski, izađe po jedan i oni se bore jedan na jedan dok svi ostali gledaju. Pa je obično ovaj čovjek izlazio, ko smije sa mnom na dvoboj i obično bi se povukli, ne smije neko da izađu. Jer znaju ako on izađe, ubiće ovog prvog, drugog, trećeg i moral će kod suprotne vojske opasti. Međutim, kad je došao kod muslimana, kaže, ko će da izađe meni na dvoboj? Ali radi Allah, on odmah je ustao, izašao njemu na dvoboj. Ali radijallahu anhu je imao tu hrabrost, veličinu. Nije bilo heroje kojem on ne bi smio da izađe na dvoboj. Pa je tako i sa merhum el-Jehudijem, jednim Jehudijom koji isto tako bio hrabar, ali radijallahu anhu bi izašao na svaki dvoboj, iako je bio i relativno mlad. Pa zato mi treba da poznajemo naše prave junake, a ne ono što nam se samo nudi kroz filmove, kroz ove superheroje koji su danas popularni među omladinom.
When we look into the seerah of the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum and what they accomplished, Wallahi, some of it is like it's a Hollywood script, like a Hollywood movie. You wouldn't think it was real, wallahi. Mission Impossible. Look at Muhammad ibn Muslima, radiallahu an. Look how he, when you read his story, look how he stood next to the Prophet ﷺ on the battlefield once the ranks were broken during the Battle of Uhud. Look at his heroic stance. Look how he was chosen by the Prophet ﷺ for the assassination of Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf, al-Yahudi, the criminal who used to slander the Prophet ﷺ and go against the Muslims and fight the Muslims, even though it was a treaty between the Muslims and the Jews that time in Medina. But the problems he was causing, and when he wanted someone to take him out, look, go back and read the story, how he did, how he got close to him, how he did it. Well, it's just like it's from a movie nowadays. And then he takes him out and how he retreats and comes back into Medina with the Muslims. That's Muhammad ibn Muslima, radiallahu an.
Možda ste čuli i za čovjeka, ashaba, kojem je Allahov poslanik, alejhi salatu vesselam, povjeravao poseban zadatak. A njegovu priču, kada čitate, kao da je pisan neki strašno uzbudljiv film. Tako to izgleda kada se uđe u detalje. To je Muhammed ibn Mesleme, radijallahu anhu. Njega je Allahov poslanik, alejhi salatu vesselam, zadužio da se uzme u koštac sa Ka'b ibn al-Ashrafom, koji je bio prvak, predvodnik u vrijeđanju, omalovažavanju, ubacivanju smutnje po pitanju Allahovog poslanika, alejhi salatu vesselam. Pa kada čitate šta je Muhammed ibn Mesleme radio, kako je pravio akciju, kako je planirao, kako je dolazio do Ka'ba ibn al-Ashrafa, to je kao da čitate neki strašno uzbudljiv događaj. Kao da je neko pisao korake šta se dešavalo, a ne da je nešto što se samo onako desilo nekada u istoriji. Pa Muhammed ibn Mesleme je još jedan od veličanstvenih primjera iz naše istorije.
I don't want everyone to think it's just the heroics on the battlefield, because we have many examples we'll mention, inshallah. But I want to mention two more examples from the story of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. From them is Al-Bara ibn Malik radiallahu an in the Battle of Yamama. He was someone who was small in stature, he was skinny. So when Musaylim al-Kadhab and his followers, they retreated into their fortress, and had a huge door they locked, the Sahaba couldn't open it. He said to them, put me up on the shield and lift me up. I'll crawl over the wall and open it. Once again, this only happens in Hollywood. People think this doesn't happen for real, right? But here it is. From the story of the Sahaba, he gets on the top of this wall and jumps in with his sword. All the guards now are rushing him to kill him. He takes 10 of them out by himself. This little skinny Sahabi takes out 10 of them by himself, radiallahu anh. Then he goes to open the door. When he's opening the door, what are they doing? MashaAllah, good job. And let him do it. Now they're stabbing him with the spears, stabbing him with this, throwing arrow, until he got stabbed more than 80 times. Allahu Akbar. But at the end, he was able to what? Open the door for the Muslims, and they came inside, alhamdulillah. Then they defeated Musaylim al-Kadhab. And after he didn't die, subhanAllah. He didn't die during this battle. He stayed there in a tent being cured. And Khalid Mawlid radiallahu anh, he stayed with him for 1 month until he was cured enough to be able to move him. And Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anh used to forbid the Muslim commanders from making him one of the commanders because he was too brave. He was too brave. He would go straight in, to like we see in this example. So he forbid them from making him a ruler, a leader of the armies, radiallahu an.
Puno je primjera iz naše historije. Ne bih sad da dužim i da spominjem sve primjera, ali evo, volio bih da zaključim ove primjere sa dva primjera. Jedan od ta dva primjera je primjer Bera ibn Malika. Bera ibn Malik je bio jedan ashab koji je bio sićušan, nizak, mršav. Međutim, kada su poslani, kada je Ebu Bekr poslao ashabe da se suprotstave Musejlemi lažovu koji je prizivao da je on poslanik nakon smrti poslanika sallallahu alejhi ve sellem, kada su došli do zamka u kojem se nalazio Musejlema, nisu znali kako da priđu u zamku. I sad zamislite, ovo je stvarni događaj, ovo nije iz nekog filma uzeta scena. Ovaj ashab Bera ibn Malik javlja se, prijavljuje se, dajte mene ubacite, prebacite me samo preko zida, ja ću vam otvoriti kapiju. I oni uzmu, pošto je bio sićušan, prebace ga preko zida, on uđe unutrašnjost zamka. I pazite ovo, sam se bori i ubija 10 ljudi. I oni ga nisu pustili, rekli, sad si ubio 10 ljudi, nećemo te više dirati. Ne, oni su njega što kopljima, što mačevima, što mačetama, izboli su ga. Izboli su ga. 80 uboda je imao na svom tijelu. Nije umro. Uspio je da otvori kapiju, muslimani su ušli i on je ostao tu da se liječi. Došao je Halid ibn Velid, ostao je sa njim mjesec dana dok se on ne oporavi. I oporavio se. Međutim, Omer radijallahu anhu nije dao da on bude vojskovođa nigdje. Kaže, previše je hrabar. Ako ga pustim, on će koji ovu jemamu navaljivati, pobiće mi ljude. Pa Omer radijallahu anhu od silne hrabrosti morao je da ga stavi sa strane da ne bi se previše dovodilo u opasnost vojske. Pa Bera ibn Malik je još jedan takav sjajni primjer iz naše historije.
Subhanallah, this next story, well, I talk about Hollywood movies. When I first read this, I said, this is from a movie. This is unreal. This was the siege of the city Testur, which is, I think it's called Shustar now in Iran. And this was the stronghold of the Persian army. And this was during the Khilafah Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anh. And the Qaid, the commander of the Muslims, was Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. They surrounded this city, the main strategic city of the Persian Empire of that time, for 18 months straight. And during that time, they would send out small brigades from their army. The Persian army is one of the strongest, and that with the Roman Empire. They're the main empires during that time, right? They would send out small brigades from the army to battle the Muslims. The Muslims fought them 80 times during those 18 months and never lost. 80-0, the Muslims. Allahu Akbar. 80-0 on the battlefield. But yet this fortress was so strongly built and the walls were so big, they couldn't get inside. So they kept around it for 18 months, not wanting to give up. They want to be victorious on this battle, open this strategic city. But what happened?
We'll tell you after the translation, inshallah.
Ima još jedan događaj koji je, kada čitate, nevjerovatan. Znači, kao da je to neka strašno dosjetljiva fikcija kada se to opisuje. To kao da je neki film kada čitate, kao da gledate film pred svojim očima. A radi se o tome da su za vrijeme Omera ibn al-Hataba radijallahu anhu muslimani za opsadu Tustera, koji se danas zove Šustar u Iranu, Perziji, opsada tog grada, tog mjesta i njihovog dvorca trajala je punih 18 mjeseci. Za tih 18 mjeseci nisu muslimani nikako uspjeli da uđu u taj grad, u taj dvorac, taj zamak, a oni su, budući da su čuvali, štitili, zidovi su bili veliki i štitili su na svaki način, povremeno bi slali konjice, čete, da pokušaju da razbiju muslimanski obrič. Došlo je do 80 bitki, 80 vojnih obračuna i ni u jednom od tih obračuna muslimani nisu izgubili. Sad ću vam ispričati šta se tu posebno desilo.
One of the people from inside, one of the workers, he came out to meet the Sahaba secretly, and he said, I know a way you can get into the castle. You can break through this fortress. He said, it's not easy, but there's a way in. He said, you guys are going to have to swim under the water, and then there's a tunnel that's going to take you out. There's some little waterfalls that comes over it, and after you go through the waterfalls, you'll be into the small waterfalls coming over, but you, once you go through these falls, you will be what? Inside of the fortress. He said, the condition is, obviously, you let me and my family go. They agreed to that. And said, don't go in anytime. He said, wait till this night, because the commander so-and-so, his daughter is going to get married. He said, all of them will be drunk. He said, around Fajr time, when you guys are going to pray before that, he said, they're going to be passed out drunk. That's when you come in. So they waited for that night. They heard them partying. And here comes the Sahaba swimming. Mission impossible. Wallahi, now, swimming under these little tunnels, coming up, getting ready, and then Allahu Akbar coming out from under the waterfalls, attacking these, and he passed out drunk soldiers, and then opening up, obviously, the doors for the rest of the soldiers to come in. And they finally conquered and finally defeated them, subhanAllah. This is one of the most amazing stories you ever hear, but yet many Muslims never heard anything about it.
Šta se desilo prilikom ove opsade? Dakle, nakon tih 18 mjeseci, nikako nisu mogli ući, ali jedne prilike jedan radnik izađe, prođe te straže i kaže muslimanima, pod uvjetom da pustite mene i moju porodicu, ja ću vam reći kako možete da uđete u ovaj zamak, u ovu tvrđavu. Kaže, ispod zidina tvrđave ima voda. Iznad te vode ima mali vodopad. Da biste ušli, vi morate proroniti ispod tog zida kroz vodu i izaći iza tog vodopada. Kaže, ako tako, samo tako možete ući, ali kaže, ne smijete ući bilo kada. Kaže, tog i tog dana vladar udaje svoju kćerku. Kaže, kada oni budu veseli, pjani, kada nakon što su se napili, budu legli, odmarali, spavali, onda vi svakako ujutru kada klanjate sabah, kaže, onda vi možete da ih napadnete i tada ćete ih sigurno osvojiti. I pazite ovo, vidite kako je nemoguća misija, doslovno jedna nemoguća misija. I oni su uradili upravo kako im je ovaj čovjek rekao. Sačekali su, čuli su zvukove, čuli su veselje. Nakon što su čuli to veselje, uradili su onako kako su im rekli i ove su zatekli ujutru mahmurne od pijanstva. Počeli su odmah da se došlo je do sukoba, otvorili su kapiju, ostatak muslimanske vojske je ušao i onda su osvojili taj zamak. Jedna nevjerovatna priča, nemoguća misija koja se desila u našoj veličanstvenoj istoriji.
Many people, they love the reformers and the activists, and they look to many non-Muslims, like, for example, Che Guevara. You see the t-shirts, Che Guevara from the Latin America, who's known for guerrilla warfare and for being a rebel and a revolutionist. He was a communist, I believe, at the same time. But then he had those sides that people like, so much so they have him on their t-shirts. They have tattoos of him, some people. And look at him being this big hero. People look at Malcolm X. Malcolm X was a Muslim. Che Guevara, people look at him as the founder of guerrilla warfare. He's the one who, not knowing that he learned guerrilla warfare from a Muslim commander, from Al-Amir Muhammad Abdul Karim Al-Khattabi, rahimahullah. And before Muhammad Abdul Karim Al-Khattabi, Imam Shamil also is the one who first started using guerrilla warfare. So this is something now, they're saying one of the most successful ways of warfare. And looking at these people as revolutionists, but the Muslims, they're the ones who learn from the Muslims, and we don't know this as Muslims, subhanAllah.
Mnogo muslimana danas kada vidite, posebno kod omladine, kada imaju buntovnički duh, kada zamišljaju nekoga ko je bio tako buntovan, ko se borio, obično tu je negdje slika Che Guevare ili na zidu, ili drži na desktopu, ili čak istetovira Che Guevaru. Iako Che Guevara smatra se, on je bio komunista, ne znam mnogo o njemu, ali smatra se da je on zasnivač gerilskog načina ratovanja. Međutim, mnogo prije Che Guevare, Emir Abdul Karim Al-Khattabi, on je bio taj koji je vodio taj gerilski način ratovanja. I prije njega Imam Šamil. Dakle, Che Guevara kod muslimana na majicama, na jaknama, na posterima, a uopšte ne znaju za ove naše velikane iz historije.
Even when you look into education, you'll see now that they're the founders of modern education, they've done this and that. Even sometimes, what is the first university in the world? One of their universities comes up in Europe. Even though many of the honest ones from there, they'll admit that the first ever university in the world, where was it?
Morocco.
Al-Qarawiyyin, they were the first ones to establish this university. By who? By a woman, on top of that. And this is in 859. And they're talking about the Christian era, right? When she established this. Fatima al-Fihri, rahimahullah ta'ala. And you look and you compare that to women's rights in the West, when 1821 in America, when they were allowed to study in universities, 1841 when they could teach in universities, and look what we did how many years before as Muslims. Even Al-Azhar is much older than all of their universities as well. So we have this in our history, but we don't know what we have in our history even when it comes to education and these things. When it comes to women's rights, look at Aisha radiallahu anha. She was someone who was a mufti in her time. Basically, as we would say, the level of a minister now. That was her status in society, even though she was a woman. And even Salama radiallahu anha, she was well known for her fiqh as well. When she was Imam al-Dhahabi in Sirah Alam al-Nubala, when he translated her biography, he said, talking about her biography, he said she was from Fuqaha al-Sahabiyat. And he mentioned that she narrated many hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, and the people who narrated from her students, by name, 101 different narrators who narrated from her, 23 of them women.
Isto tako, kada pomene se univerzitet, osnivanje školskih, visokoškolskih institucija, obično prvo što padne ljudima na pamet i što sa zapada potenciraju, jeste kao da su kod njih osnovani univerziteti. Međutim, prije toga osnovani su univerziteti u muslimanskom, u islamskom svijetu. I vi ste spomenuli da je to univerzitet Kajrvan u Fesu, koji je, usput rečeno, osnovala žena, Fatima Fihrija. Žena. U vrijeme, dakle to je oko 859. godine, u vrijeme kada žene nisu se ništa pitale, nisu ništa značile u zapadnom društvu. Dakle, daleko prije nego što se počelo pričati o pravima žena. Za razliku od toga, kakav je status imala Aisha, majka vjernika, radijallahu ta'ala anha? Ona je bila ono što bi se danas nazivalo muftijom, velikim učenjakom, koji izdaje fetve ljudima za pitanja kojima oni ne znaju kako da se ponašaju. Ne samo Aisha radijallahu anha, to bi danas, ona bi bila danas na nivou nekog ministra edukacije ili obrazovanja u današnjem društvu. Isto tako Imam Zehebi u svom poznatom dijelu Sijara Alaminu Bela spominje važnost Umu Seleme, poslanikove alihi salatu wasalam supruge. Umu Selema, on je ubraja u najučenije žene u islamskom pravu među ashabima, općenito drugovima Allahovog poslanika, alihi salatu wasalam. To davno, davno prije nego što je postojala priča o ljudskim pravima u zapadnom svijetu.
If you look what the scholars of Islam did when it came to Islamic knowledge, we talked about Sir al-Amma Nubala, which you can see here on the side. It's about 20 plus volumes over here, the Sheikh can show us. This is it. This is the biographies through the scholars of Islam throughout history. Imam al-Dhahabi went into detail up to the 700s when he passed away, rahimahullah ta'ala. And we have, for example, Tahdhib al-Kamal, Imam al-Mizzi, who is his Sheikh. Tahdhib, which is a shortened version of the Kamal, which is just about the translations or the biographies of the ones who narrated the six books of hadith. And that is imprinted and also in 36 volumes. We see the fatawa of Sheikh Islam Taymiyyah also over here, 37 volumes. That was the knowledge of our scholars when it comes to knowledge. So much so that the biggest library perhaps in the world, some say, is the Library of Congress in America. And the biggest section they have is Islamic books. One of the scholars who visited them, he's speaking to the guy in charge there, he said, if we wanted to take all of these books and move them somewhere else, this is like 20 years ago, so it's probably even more now, he said, we would need 17 big semi-trucks, the huge trucks, to fill them up. He said, maybe that would be enough to carry all of the Islamic books. This is what our scholars do when it comes to Islamic knowledge.
Isto tako, braći i sestre, kada je u pitanju biografija ljudi, učenjaka, kroz istoriju, muslimani prednjače u odnosu na sve druge narode, naročito u odnosu na zapad. Pa, na primjer, jedna od knjiga koja sažima biografije učenjaka kroz istoriju od poslanika alejhi salatu vesselam do imama ovoga autora, imama Zehebija, je ova knjiga Sijar Alam Nubela, gdje je on kroz svoj rad u desetine tomova napisao biografije svih poznatijih učenjaka, ovo samo poznatiji učenjaci, kroz istoriju. Gdje je do svojeg života, dakle do godine kada je on umro, a to je 748. do polovine 8. hidžretskog stoljeća, napisao sve važnije biografije. To je samo jedan primjer. Potom imam Mizi, on je u svojoj knjizi u 30 i nešto tomova napisao biografije svih prenosilaca ili gotovo svih prenosilaca hadisa. Sistematski. Takvo nešto ne postoji. Tu vidite, ima, pa je šejh pokazao, i zbirna djela od šejhul Islama Ibn Tejmije. Pa kažu, sada kad biste pitali gdje se nalazi najveća biblioteka na svijetu, on će vam reći, to je kongresna biblioteka ili biblioteka pri Američkom kongresu. A znate šta? Ta biblioteka ima puno odjela. Najveći odjel, odjel koji ima najviše knjiga je onaj islamska, dio sa islamskom literaturom. Do te mjere, i sad ovo je podatak od prije 20 godina, kaže on. Do te mjere, da su rekli, ako bi morali da premjestimo knjige iz ove biblioteke, trebalo bi nam 17 šlepera samo za islamske knjige. Ovakvu biblioteku, ovakvo nasljeđe, ne postoji u istoriji čovječanstva da neko ima kao što imaju muslimani.
Subhanallah, even if you look, alhamdulillah, now this was one of the good things or the blessings that we have in the ummah, even though I still believe it hasn't been utilized enough. And that is, for example, the work 1001 Inventions. That kind of revived in a way to remind the Muslims what we've done throughout history. Because most of us don't know, not just the stories we mentioned tonight, but even if you look at many of the modern inventions, whether it be in medicine, in science, the foundations were laid down by Muslim scholars. If you look, for example, at modern aviation, who created the first plane? They say the Wright brothers, of course. Yeah, USA, huh? They're the ones who did it. Who laid down the foundation? Abbas ibn Farnas. He did everything. The miskin just forgot the tail in the end. That's the only thing he didn't reach. But the whole thing, how to design a plane, how to fly, all of that, the foundation was laid by him. The Wright brothers came, took what he had done, added the tail at the end, and they had the first plane flying through there. And give example after example, you'll find the modern camera that we're using goes back to an invention by the Muslims, all by Muslim scholars. This is when we truly understood our religion and understood it was for us to excel in both the deen and the dunya. That's when we were truly successful. We ruled upon the earth and we spread the khair upon the earth. Alhamdulillah.
I zato, braćo i sestre, kada pogledamo, na primjer, šta su ljudi izumili u medicini, u tehnologiji, obično što ljudima prvo padne na pamet jeste da sve što je do sad tehnološki uznapredovalo, bazirano je ili ima isključivo korijene u zapadnoj civilizaciji. Međutim, nije tako. Ono što je poznato kao 1001 izum, većina izuma ili veliki izumi koji su bili prekretnica za kasniji tehnološki napredak zapravo su desili se kod muslimana. Pa ako biste rekli ko je izmislio letenje ili avion, rekli biste da su to oni Wright braća Wright koji su prvi letjeli. Međutim, ko je prije njih izmislio taj sistem? Ko je postavio temelj da oni mogu na taj temelj se nadovezati? Bili su to muslimani. Pa čak kaže i ove kamere koje mi danas koristimo, osnova za njihovo korištenje je ono što su izmislili muslimani. Većina ljudi to zapravo ne zna ili namjerno zanemaruje.
The take-home message that I want to remind myself and my brothers and sisters of is the importance of reviving in our life knowing who the true heroes of humanity are. And they are, alhamdulillah, from our deen. They are the Muslims who laid down the foundation of the deen in the dunya. The Muslims who were brave and spread Islam and spread the khayr throughout the earth. We need to remind ourselves, first of all, who they are, and then revive this also with our children as well, to let them know the great history. I was very happy to see some Muslim kids who play around the world in the streets now with their little swords pretending to be Urturul. The kid coming out with two swords pretending to be Bamse. Yeah? Because they want to, what, like I said, they're looking at the movies and this, I know there's some issues, and he said, don't get me wrong, but the point being, at least they understood that we have these heroes in Islam, right? Which they didn't know before. So when they know this, the greatness of what it means to be a Muslim, and the impact that it has, and he, this is going to be very powerful. We said, we're talking about how do we make change? See, look, one of the key ways is to understand the great history that we have, the great heroes that we have, to revive knowing this and implementing this, acting upon this and benefiting from them in our lives and the life of our families as well, inshallah ta'ala.
Draga braćo i cijenjene sestre, ono što želim da postignem sa ovim svojim izlaganjem i na što želim da ukažem jeste da revitaliziramo, da oživimo kod sebe ove vrijednosti koje su spomenute u našoj istoriji. Ono što se spominje u našoj istoriji. Da znamo da je naša istorija bogata sa velikanima, bogata sa junacima, bogata sa tehnološkim izumima. I ono što mene posebno raduje, eto vidio sam, kaže, neka djeca muslimanska, kaže, igraju se sa mačevima, kaže, glume ko će biti Ertogul, ko će biti osvajač. Ne glume sada neke junake tamo, super junake, već glume ili žele da budu kao pravi velikani iz naše istorije. I vidite, mi trebamo kod sebe da gajimo ovu stvar, da o ovoj stvari pričamo, jer imamo čime da se ponosimo iz naše istorije, da to prenosimo na svoju djecu, da imamo povjerenje da će ono što je kod nas bilo od blagodati donijeti pozitivna kretanja kod nas u društvu, a i kod nas će, na nas će djelovati izrazito pozitivno.
Wallahu alemu sallahu sallam wa baraka nabiju Muhammadu, jazakumullahu khairan.
Allah najbolje zna i neka su salavati salam na poslanika sallallahu alaihi sallam. Allah vas nagradi.
Jazakumullahu khairan.